There's so many things we can say about liquid crystal water. This talk is by no means a complete expose of the clinical theory of everything or of healing and the new understandings of physics. But I did want to mention that in quantum physics, there are multiple interpretations of the observations of quantum physics, the strangeness of that subatomic world where we get to see that essentially there is no substance, there is only energy, that what we appears as substance is a standing waveform. It's a coherence zone in space-time, as I would call it. Coherent in space, matter is coherent in space, has a localization that has consistency through time, and it's the resistance to change of that is inertia, and mass has to do with that. But one of those interpretations that's in the running is one that does interpret quantum physics as the fact that time is reversible. At that level of view, there is no uniqueness to forward or reverse time. It's only at a macroscopic level that we have the irreversibility of time. And I propose that that's only when we're outside of a coherence zone. So in the coherent state, reverse time is has equal potential to the forward state. And the spirit body and the fundamental structure and function of consciousness is a transcendence, a coherence across time, across space. And hopefully we'll get to talk more about that. But moving forward, condensates are another state of matter. This accepted modern physics, the 2001 Nobel Prize for Bose-Einstein condensates, and there's many other forms of condensates that have now been documented, including light, most recently in 2010. Light has mass in a condensate state. So in a condensate state where I'm saying time travels forward and back in a vortex and is not on a linear path as we experience it, the arrow of time, in that condensate state, we have space and time and movement and interaction and functions are what we see at a quantum level. This quantum strangeness of you can move from here to there without moving through the space in between. So that's a coherence across a trans-dimensional coherence across space. Just like memory, we model as a trans-dimensional coherence across time. So at this level, we can transcend the apparent separations of space and time that are only apparent in our macroscopic world where we have these things that are not coherent. Heat, randomness. What appears random is a lack of coherence that each particle is moving differently. They're not all moving together. Therefore, we can consider them separate particles, where in fact, when we look inside each particle, each one is its own wave form. So each one ultimately is its own coherence zone. We have many coherence zones working more or less independently within whatever the next level of structural organization is, which has its coherence, but within that coherence, there's also freedom, and that's the freedom is entropy, is the ability to have heat, to be different than the next particle or next person. We're gonna touch lightly on these concepts, but these are all critical concepts to have in mind in understanding how the body works and how we can guide that function toward a greater state of coherence, which is the state of what we call accelerated self-healing. All healing is self-healing, but we can accelerate that. We can facilitate that. We can arrange conditions for learning, growth, development, and healing, which is represents an increase in coherence. Okay, so the condensates we model as the substrate of the spirit body, which is the vessel of consciousness. Let me describe that a little bit because those are great words and they might sound like maybe they mean something, but you probably have no clue what I'm saying. So the condensates that we're talking about are what I consider to be the real dark matter of the universe, not the same identity of dark matter that's being looked for based on conventional models of the cosmos, where I believe they've, in our model, we say that they've made certain fundamental assumptions, and assumptions are a major source of error, a major type of error philosophically. For example, when Einstein made the simplifying assumption in order to be able to do his thought experiments about the universe, he made the assumption that the dominant force at a cosmological level is gravity. It's not the case. We modeled that electromagnetism is the dominant force, and that in fact gravity, which is an unknown nature of force in conventional thinking, is just a subset, a form of energy, form of electromagnetism, but one that is not dominant on the largest scales in the universe, because it falls off. It's produced, first of all, it comes from bodies that are centered on a point. They're not linear in extent. They're spherically symmetrical. So they're point-related objects. They have a center point, center of gravity, we call it. And so if we have a center of gravity, the force between two centers of gravity falls off with distance in relation to the inverse of the square of the radius of the distance between those two objects. Yet we have linear objects in the universe. We can see them. we can take pictures of them. Even more so now, we're getting finer scale pictures of them in our galaxy and others. And these are in physics, in plasma physics, called Birkeland currents, and they're scalable to at least 16 orders of magnitude from the scale of our biological system, where we'll talk about them as how the meridians function and coordinate and integrate with each other, to the cosmic scale. And because they're linear, the forces of magnetism that they produce by the movement of charge, just as the movement of charge moves through our meridians, and it's documented in the body, those magnetic forces from a linear source fall off much, much more slowly over, I believe it's the inverse of the square root of the radius, but I'll check on that. Don't quote me yet. But it's much more pervasive force in the universe, it's much more explanatory. Where conventional cosmology keeps getting surprised by every new observation of the universe, it's like, oh my goodness, this, you know, we're seeing objects in the universe that are, quote, impossible, in the news stories, impossible quasars and impossible galaxies and impossible neutron stars. And yes, they're impossible because they falsify the model that we conventionally are proposing to explain them. It's not explanatory. As soon as we falsify that model, we need a new model. And fortunately there is a new model. So so the condensates are, to bring it down to now the biological level that we're focusing on today, the condensates are essentially superfluid, superconductive forms of the transition minerals. I'm not calling them the transition metals because the metallic state is a different state of matter. Let's say you have a solid metal of gold. That's a very different form and function in the body than a gold condensate or a gold ormus, as it's being called by modern alchemists who are working with these clinically. So they coordinate with each other like water does, like the liquid crystalline state of water. They form a liquid crystalline state of condensates, of ormus, or of spirit minerals, I like to call them. and these are planar, two-dimensional, but they're superfluid, so they can change shape, they can move through space, they can move through physical objects. They can move in and out of the biological system. They can move out of the biological system, and we can, because it's the substrate of consciousness, consciousness is the center, the locus of consciousness, and the perspective of consciousness is now carried with that spirit body, with that ghost, out of the body, in an out-of-body experience, a near-death experience. And there are cases on record of impossible, from conventional models, impossible experiences where people, a woman had an out-of-body experience. She had a heart attack. Her dead body was, her brain was flatlined, her heart was stopped, her dead body, biologically speaking, was on the gurney. And she saw that from the upper corner of the room. She did not identify with that because it's out there relative to her perceptual locus, her cyclopean eye, we call it in vision, of the nonius horopter, where we measure the geometry of how we see the world. And that geometry of the eye and the world is not the same as the biological and the physical structure. It's its own geometry of this of these condensates that make up the spirit body. So she was able to see that when the blonde-haired nurse took her glasses off and put them on the lower tray of the stainless steel tray instrument tray next to the gurney, that maybe her glasses could be found there. And so they found her glasses after she recovered, you know, they started her heart again. And she was able to tell the staff, you know, who took the glasses off and where she put them. And nobody else remembered that. And her body certainly didn't remember it, and her brain was flatlined. So consciousness is not synonymous with an epiphenomenon of the brain. It's an epiphenomenon of the spirit body, perhaps, yes. And we propose in the clinical theory of everything that this universe that we experience is an epiphenomenon of the divine consciousness, of the universal consciousness, the universal brain. And if we look at the structure of these Birkeland currents that I mentioned in the cosmos, they look identical to the structure of our neurons, identical to the structure of the mycelia in fungi, which we know that fungal spores are the most biologically capable organisms, living things, of surviving the conditions in space. Well, and we don't even, that's not even considering Birkeland currents having their own space that's not outer space. They have their own inner space that connect as a wormhole, is how I model it, between cosmological bodies. So, in other words, biological material that's more sensitive may be able to travel from one celestial body to another intact. And this would very nicely explain the observation in geology, what we see as punctuated equilibrium, that evolution of species is something that happens in the geological sense, geological record, instantaneously. All of a sudden, there's new heavens, new earth, there's newness, there's new species, there's all this change all at one time in a break in the geological record. And that would be explained by Birkeland currents coming through the galactic arms, which we're in on the edge of one of those arms right now. Those are Birkeland currents feeding into the center of the galaxy. They tend to happen in pairs, just like stars. You know, this explains why stars are mostly paired celestial structures, because Birkeland currents have this magnetic field attraction where they come together, just like blood vessels. We have in the growth of the body, the artery and the vein are carriers for Birkeland currents from the energy of the heart, and they travel in pairs, just like Birkeland currents do in a cosmological sense. So there's all these parallels of as above, so below. And back to the liquid crystal water in relation to the condensates, what we're proposing is that the liquid crystal water has pi electrons that, because of their similarity throughout this hexagonal sheet, honeycomb sheet structure, they all have a relatively equivalent energetic state, which means they no longer act as separate electrons. They're no longer a thing. They're now a field of electrons. where they're not separate. They're one field, one unified field. And that field is a what we call a coherence zone. And this coherence zone, again, is easy. It's an exclusion zone. It pushes out things that are not coherent with that field. But it'll pull in things which are coherent with that field, such as the planar structure of the condensates, the spirit minerals of the conscious body, of the ghost in the machine. And so there we have a different view of what's happening in the body and how we can relate to a healthy cell being not just the cell membrane and inside the cell membrane, but a field that extends out into the home of every cell, the connective tissue, the matrix, the living matrix. And if we have two cells, a multicelled organism, those fields from two cells can now coalesce, and they will actually push out toxins and wastes and viruses and anything else that doesn't belong into the open-ended lymph vessel. So it's a new mechanism for understanding detoxification, is by energizing the cells, energizing the living water around the cells, and by virtue of the limitation of collagen, having a limiting the space between cells, like a wire or a rope, it creates a pressure that water, as it absorbs in its absorption spectrum of, especially in the near infrared, but also far infrared and UV, it's clear to visible light, so we don't see the difference in water. When there's a meniscus on water, we don't see the difference particularly, but it is different, and that's why a water bug can walk on that water. It's sheets of hexagonal structure. One molecule is now the size of a pool, and then the next molecule is the next layer. So in these sheets, we have the formation of the condensate sheets of consciousness. Now, in the water, I would propose that we're probably looking at the subconscious. So biological intelligence can increase as our water becomes structured, and it absorbs light energy to structure itself. And the larger the volume of that coherent zone of structured water, the higher the frequency that water is able to release as a photon, a quantum energy. And that quantum energy can now begin to run more and more of the biological systems in the body, starting with ones that take lower energy but increasing to higher energy states, enzymes that take higher quantum energy to reach an enzyme substrate complex, a coordination complex that can cause that reaction to go forward. We know that the function of enzymes is to reduce the required energy for that complex to take place, because it uses basically a little laser of, it could be a mineral or a vitamin typically, or multiple of those, as the resonant energy source to deliver that energy. But now we know that enzyme only has to be in contact with this structured water in order, and that water only needs to be in a certain volume in order to activate the photonic, the energy need, the quantum energy need of that reaction. And now all you need is the substrate, whether it's one for electrolysis of breaking apart, you only need that one molecule to be in contact with that water, and it will immediately go through the reaction. It doesn't have to fit into the lock and key. It does fit into the lock and key model, but it doesn't have to when there's a coherence zone involved. It just has to be in contact with the coherence zone, along with the volume of the coherence zone to be able to run that particular chemical reaction, which the energy level is reduced if that appropriate enzyme is functional, in a functional state. In other words, not containing a heavy metal where there should be, you know, not containing mercury where there should be zinc, for example. And from my experiences in the healing process, I also modeled that the spirit minerals will knock out those heavy metals from those blocking positions in the cell membrane. It's not only enzymes, it's transmembrane proteins that are the pores that allow certain materials to go in and out of the cell. All of these kinds of functional pathways and facilitation are facilitated by the spirit minerals knocking the heavy metals out of place, where they block the appropriate minerals from doing their job as little photon sources with the right frequency. Amplifiers. Enzymes are amplifiers. So we've talked about coherence zones and the fact that these water structures now can grow to multicellular size. In fact, it can grow to your whole body. If your whole body is in a spiritual state, we call that being a living saint, and you actually see the light emission from the plasmoid, which is an energy field around the head, just like we talk about the water field and the energy field around each cell. So as that's true for every cell, it becomes true for the body as a whole. There's many observations through history of, for example, people in that spiritually energized and healthy state, being able to levitate, being able to bilocate, being able to heal, all of these functions that parallel the functions of matter when we look into it at a quantum level become true when the quanta become coordinated into a macroscopic or life-size coherence zone. The five phases of health is a very important part of the clinical theory. I've talked about phase one being the low energy state, and so there's four other states as we progress into higher and higher sizes of these coherence zones, higher and higher energy levels, different functions come online. In phase two, if we're healing, the functions that begin to come online is we have enough size of that coherence zone to begin to run the enzyme apparatus of the cell, including, again, the transmembrane enzymes, essentially, that transport material in and out of the cell and transport communication in and out of the cell, communicating, for example, hormonal reactions like we talked about insulin. The only hormone that goes directly through the membrane and directly through the mitochondrial and nuclear membrane to communicate directly with every cell at an epigenetic level is melatonin, the hormone that transmits information about the light-dark cycle, the day-night diurnal cycle. So the five phases we can also define not only in terms of these energy levels and the types of things that happen at those levels, like bacteria and parasite infestations happen in that second level we call phase two. Rapid aging happens in phase two when the energy level is going down. And because aging is a loss of function, if we increase the energy, the function comes back. We reverse aging. And that's also where spontaneous remission happens. And it's seen to come along with bacterial infection, where bacteria bring in enzymes that will work in that train when ours don't, because ours may be blocked by heavy metals or we don't have enough energy for that particular enzyme to work. Fungi are in the third phase, which is where we can regenerate, where if we're healing, we have enough energy to clear the space of dead matter, because that is the function of those coherent zones of water to create an exclusion zone. When we've excluded the waste materials, now there's room for a cell that has enough energy, that has double the energy at the cell membrane potential that it needs to function. It can divide into two cells and have two cells in that space of one and now regenerate. We know the liver, for example, can regenerate from 5% of its tissue or even less to 100% full liver function. And other tissues that, you know, we used to learn when I went to school, the brain cells don't regenerate, now they do. You know, we just don't know. Everything can regenerate. DNA can regenerate from no DNA. Damaged DNA can regenerate healthy DNA structure can regenerate in the coherence zone of the healthy body into the normal state from a damaged state. The Nobel Prize winning scientist showed that you could take DNA, create an image of it with crossed lasers, create a holographic image in a beaker and glass, take out the DNA, put in the pieces of DNA, put in the laser to create that holographic waveform, the spatial structure energetically, the field. And if you have the field, the coherent field of the DNA, the little pieces would come together and reform the exact same DNA. So this is how the spirit body has the capacity to regenerate the physical body in the right environment, in a truly healing environment. So light all along the way here is playing a critical role. It's not the only thing that's happening. There's certainly material substance and energy, electricity and magnetism and all that. But ultimately, one leading physicist who is considered the successor to Einstein as a thinker proposed, all matter is frozen light. And there's actually a model of the electron that is perfectly suited to that intuition that David Bohm had. And that says that if we take a photon, a light wave, a light quantum, and we wrap it on itself in a half wavelength shape, on a half wavelength track, so it's going back over itself twice in one wavelength, that is an electron. Okay, so that's a frozen electron, and it has a little mass. Oh, just like the coherence zone formed by a condensate of light, of photons, when they put in between two mirrors atomically close together, super close together. The light is in a hall of mirrors and it goes back and forth on a short enough path, and now it's essentially forming an electron and having the magnetic field compressed on the inside, forming mass effect, that inertia, that localization, and the electrical field on the outside, and we call it an electron. Right, and what do photons of light interact with? They're absorbed by electrons. The electrons are on the outside of the atom. In the inside, we have the protons and neutrons, and the mass, right, is closer together and more dense. But all these are coherence zones. It's the electron is a photon, a quantum of energy that's mass and energy equivalent by E equals MC squared. Thank you, Einstein. He made some mistakes, but that one was a good one. And the mistakes were good too. He was thinking. He had thought experiments. So the conclusions he came to in his thought experiments, we interpret as the structure of consciousness, of thought, of perception. You know, the whole idea of space and time warping. Well, that's how we perceive it. Yes, but it's not the actual hard physics of it. You know, I know everybody believes it is because you can point to certain evidence that supports that, but it's explained by other explanations where there's other data that actually disproves that theory. We can go into another time. But since I'm talking to optometrists, my favorite one, the brief one, is that you can measure the effect of, supposedly, of gravity on light, bending light, right? If the space-time continuum is warped by mass, by the presence of mass, by the gravitational field, then light bends. Well, and they've measured the bending of starlight at the limb of the sun. But they've also measured beyond the limb of the sun, and there is no bending. It's only where the sun has an atmosphere of plasma that the light is bent. So it's a function of plasma. And the amount of bending does correspond to the gravity, but so does the plasma. So there's another mechanism at work. Okay, so light has a quintessential role in chemistry. Every chemical reaction is exchange of a quantum of electromagnetic energy, and we call that quantum light if it's within the visible spectrum. Beyond that, it's ultraviolet or it's infrared or it's, you know, other electromagnetic field frequency ranges, but all in that same 88 octave keyboard of the electromagnetic spectrum, in which light, visible light, is one octave. Happens to be the octave where there's the maximum energy coming from the sun and where there's the maximum activity going on in the biological system, including vision. But the other octaves like UV and infrared that are absorbed by water in the body and become biologically structured water that acts as a battery, that holds energy, that, you know, we now is a second way that the body can can live and can live without any damage. So it makes the biology immortal if we're living through absorption of light. And there's actually a few cases now that have been of breatharians. You know, I'm not promoting breatharianism. I'm saying there are people who have that. These are people who are called to a spiritual path generally, and they're experiencing this. They're not striving for it. But they've been studied, a couple of them, where, yes, it's been confirmed that they are living without taking in food or water. They're breathing. They're getting enough water vapor in their breathing to balance whatever's coming out with urination, and they're not eating food. And there's bacterial species that have been identified now that also can have been confirmed can live on electrical fields alone. So chemistry is an interaction of light and electrons, essentially. It's electrons that are shared by atomic nuclei that form bonds, and it's a change in the quantum energy level of those electron orbitals. Shared orbitals are becoming separate or separate becoming shared. The quantum energy change is an amount of light energy, using the term light broadly now, that it could be in the visible spectrum, it could be at either end of that. But most of the activity is indeed in the visible spectrum. So light is the ultimate nutrient. When you eat food, it's just another way of indirectly getting light. It means some other organism ate that light photosynthetically. We are photosynthetic, we now know that. We synthesize these sheets of water. We can synthesize millions of sheets of water in a minute with infrared, which our own body emits. But when we're eating food from plants or animals that ate plants, it's sunlight stored in those chemical bonds, carbon-carbon bonds, that's released in the electron transport chain in our mitochondria, which are little bacteria that live in our cells. Good reason not to take conventional antibiotics, because they're antibacterial, and they do knock out our own mitochondria, which is our life force. 90% of the energy released by oxidative metabolism, as opposed to photonic metabolism that we're talking about with absorbing light, the oxidative metabolism in the mitochondria, which we're not dependent on the mitochondria for the photonic metabolism, but we are for oxidative metabolism. Without that, our cell cytoplasm can only ferment, fungal metabolism essentially, instead of bacterial, and we're only able to get about 10% of the energy from sugar. So light is the ultimate nutrient. There's a correspondence energetically between the retina of the eye, where we absorb light most efficiently, although our skin absorbs light, and we do feel visible light as heat on the skin. There's recent research on that, that it's not only the infrared that we're feeling, or UV effects that can give us sunburn or make vitamin D, but we feel visible light from the sun on our skin as warmth and heat. And we're not the only animal that enjoys that occasionally. But of course, if we're toxic, whatever's toxic in there is going to absorb it and be energized by its electrons going into more active orbitals, more likely to go into a chemical reaction. And so there was a study in Australia years ago where sunbathers who ate margarine versus butter had 700% more skin cancer. So we need to be clean in order to metabolize light efficiently as a photosynthetic organism. So let's talk about light and biocommunication. It's not just energy, it's also information. Every type of vortex can be thought of as an eye. An eye can be thought of as a vortex that's similar in structure and function in a way, energetically and informationally, as the so the eye and the vortex. The eye of a storm, the eye of a hurricane. So every Birkeland current is essentially a hurricane. Sometimes they'll call them tornadoes in space, or you know, tornado. They're just beginning to measure the strong, powerful electrical fields around these kinds of vortices that come down from the cosmos to our planet. It's energy that comes from the sun, which ultimately comes from the galaxy, galactic center, which ultimately comes from our local galactic cluster, which comes from the supercluster, which comes from somewhere. But all of these actually come from the fact that they're organized and structured cosmically as a cell membrane of the cellular structure of the cosmos. The space in the cosmos between galaxies, between galactic superclusters, is these three-dimensional spaces where we say, oh, there's no matter there. Well, there's actually plasma there, and I propose that it's in a relatively coherent state because the plasma, the particles of the plasma are widely distributed, and they can therefore take up an equal energetic state and stop being separate beings, separate things. They're now one field of energy. And so, again, all the material substance is organized in these vortices of ever decreasing size all the way down to electrons, and even a quantum of light is a spiral vortex. And they carry information. So light, we know that from Fritz Popp's work in Europe, that cells, the mitochondria especially, and the DNA emit and absorb these biophotons of communication that are actually laser-like. They're coherent. Interesting. They're coming from the coherent zones of the biological system, which we also see in the DNA, which are in the mitochondria and our own nucleus. The sugars of the DNA are of course organized in a double helix spiral, and they also have, like the structured water, they have pi electrons, which then can become a double helix, the same shape as Birkeland currents, the preferred shape of electromagnetic waves to interact with matter and to create matter and to communicate across space-time with matter. So the DNA is the perfect antenna, and we know that the DNA restructures itself when the field changes, when the environment of the cell changes, the cell senses that, receives it, has sensors on the cell membrane. There's tremendous evidence that we look at in the clinical theory that what we think of as our consciousness, our biological organismic level of consciousness, has everything to do with what's happening at the cell membrane level. That there's, you know, we propose that consciousness is a fractal, so we're seeing it on our level as any one of your cells sees it on its cellular level. But at our level, when we knock out consciousness with an anesthetic, a general anesthetic, we know that, first of all, they contain residues of chlorine and fluoride, which knock out consciousness, and they knock out the coherence, the structural and energetic coherence of the membrane. They knock out its structural coherence because the microtubules on the inside and outside of the cell that come together at rafts of combined cholesterol and ceramides, those rafts lose their coherence and they lose their connectivity with the microtubules, and so the shape of the cell changes. We know that change in the shape of a cell membrane of a neuron is associated with memory. So we lose the shape, we've lost our memory. People come out of anesthesia oftentimes with memory loss, if they come out with intact personality. Sometimes we lose aspects of personality. So at a cellular level, what we're proposing is that those vortices, those rafts, those portals are energetic portals that regulate the biocommunication that creates coherence between the inside and outside of the cell. We know that in the ORC OR, that's ORCH, capital OR, model of consciousness, it's the microtubules that are the only physical model of memory that's been able to account for the amount of bits of data that we have potentially in a human lifetime of memory. In our model, we'll go a step further and say that those microtubules actually are acting as the antenna to, and sometimes as the locus, the location of the actual memory, which would be the M-state minerals, the spirit minerals, and that the presence of those minerals at the microtubule then links the spirit body to the physical biological body, and so that we're able to experience our senses, our bodily senses, and able to, in a coherent state, we know that memory is state dependent. So if you're in the same similar state to when you experience something, you can recall it. That's when the spirit memory, which contains all the memory, is able to download that particular set of memories in that state of the biology. So when the spirit body leaves the physical body, the biological body, then there's this flood of memory, of a whole lifetime of memories that floods through as we're no longer perceiving through the filter of the biological, but perceiving directly. Key point on photonic biocommunication is that if we look at the structure of a mitochondria, its structure is the structure of a laser. And they're responsible for this laser-like coherent light. And 80-90% of them in our neurons, at least, are actually located on the microtubules, which are perfectly structured as antennas and as transmitters, as transmitter receivers of that light energy communication. And so all the pieces are there to tell us that light is being communicated between cells. That light signal can go thousands of cells away, and the distance only really depends on coherence zones, because it can go extend beyond at a macroscopic biological level, organismic level. We know from studies on remote viewing and remote healing that there are quantum effects thousands of miles away in real time, not even dependent on transmission of a field, but by the function of what would be called non-locality, the non-locality function at a quantum level, which I would say is a bilocation spiritually. We call it bilocation when a person is in two places at one time, or you know, energetically in one place while they're physically in the other place. And that's a function of the spirit minerals, that they are only 5/9, typically 5/9 mass present in the here now, in the spirit as it's having an in-body experience, like right now. And 4/9 is wherever you're thinking about, of that particular mineral that's carrying that particular qualia of consciousness, that essence of consciousness, actually is where you think it is. It may not be where the object really is that you're thinking about, but when the two correspond, that's when they were able to measure quantum effects in remote healing. And so the sites where there was quantum effects was where the healing took place, and where it didn't take place, it didn't take place. So there's wormhole connections through the spirit minerals to wherever we're thinking, not limited by space-time. So the stars, or also the future and the past, in the clinical theory of everything. Don't ask me to prove it yet. Except on case-by-case basis. Besides, you can't prove a theory. Conventional theories are not proven, none of them. We cannot ever prove a theory, we can only prove it wrong. And there's plenty of proofs that our conventionally held theories are wrong. We need to look at the data points that falsify those theories and say, well, what would be the bigger theory that accounts for that? Just like when Piaget looked at child development, he saw, oh, children create a theory about how the world works. You know, they create a theory, oh, there's something there, now it's gone. Now it's there, now it's gone. And eventually they get enough experience where they say, there's something else, there's a bigger world out there, there's more going on, there's space behind that head, the thing is really there. And they have now the concept of coherence of an object. We're still working on that, aren't we? We can take our thinking to a higher level. Like Einstein said, we're never going to solve the problems we've created using the same level of consciousness and thinking that we use to create those problems. Yeah, good one. So the photovoltaic meridian vessels, the meridian vessels of acupuncture, are, I'm proposing, are carrying energy, electrical energy. We can measure that. We measure it every day in the clinic by impedance. And what is impedance? It's the equivalent of resistivity or conductivity in a wire, but these wires are not insulated against each other. So it's more like a Tesla ball where the energies can shift and move, and that's what we measure. Oh, all the energy's over here. There's too much over here, and there's not enough over there. Why? It's being recruited to help bring more energy to a task that needs more energy to reach the quantum level to make a certain action happen. But if we put in the right catalysts, oh, now suddenly the energy is all flowing smoothly through all the meridian vessels, and that tells us that we're not having to do that recruitment. We've supplied the material substrates, the energies, the photonic blueprint information that we need in order to allow the body to work coherently as a whole, as one team, rather than dividing and being conquered. So I mentioned along the way the cosmic relationship, as above, so below, between the structure of the cosmos. When modern conventional science looks at the cosmos and plots out where is the dark matter, where's the missing matter they're looking for, and I believe there is matter there, but it's not just the mass of dark matter that they're claiming. It's some of it is the mass of the dark matter, which is not the dark matter they're looking for. It's not the droids they're looking for. The dark matter that's there is the spirit minerals. It's everywhere. It's there's a tremendous amount in the seawater. When they measured the one study that actually measured brain tissue of a pig, but pigs are smart animals, the brain tissue of a pig, of the dry weight, 5% was in this condensate state, which in every other chemistry lab on the planet, other than where they developed the technique in Russia and the one lab that replicated it once in the US that did the study, that 5% would typically not get recorded. If at all, would get recorded as a certain mass of unknown. It's unknown. There's no research on unknown. Well, there is. We know what the unknown is. But you can't measure it in normal atmosphere. You need special equipment and special atmosphere to burn it extra long. And then you can measure, oh, it's gold and it's iridium and it's rhodium, and 5% of the dry weight, dry mass of your brain, of a pig's brain, and we're proposing of your brain, maybe yours is a little different, it might be higher in humans, we don't know yet, but 5% of that dry weight is rhodium and iridium. Amazing. You know, every time the planet changes in the geological record, there's a bunch of iridium in that layer. Oh, what's that about? Yeah, we have theories on all these things. So, and they all fit together very well. So these neurovascular bundles that accompany the acupuncture points where the meridian energy comes to the surface, some of these points are used in classical acupuncture. Others have been identified since the 1950s in German diagnostic electroacupuncture, over 800 points around the body, each point with three or more clinical cases documenting that that particular point has a holographic homunculus relationship to a certain body part or function based on physical data of like MRIs and CAT scans and all that. Similar cases, oh, this point on the large intestine meridian corresponds to this point, this area of the ascending colon, because here's the cases. Okay, great. We know that it's a holographic representation. Well, everything is. Every cell has the DNA for all parts of our body. It's holographically represented. The ear, the iris of the eye, the white of the eye, the soles of the hands and feet in reflexology, all of it is reflex. The face has zones, the colon reflects to all the different organs. So we're a hologram. And so we can use that diagnostically and therapeutically to, without being invasive, without damaging the thing that we're trying to heal, without doing harm, at least in our first attempts at supporting and stimulating healing. So every acupuncture point we know now structurally is a neurovascular bundle. That means an artery and a vein, which are two plasma vessels, just like the plasma vessels in the cosmos that carry Birkeland currents of energy. These are the plasma vessels that go in pairs. It's the physics, the mathematics of it causes them to do that. It's how they're made. It's like, oh, it's all made male and female, or outbound and inbound. I'm just beginning to hypothesize what that is on a cosmic level. The plasma physicists haven't thought of that, but we're seeing it biologically, that there's a difference between an artery and a vein, and yet they travel in pairs. There's something going on. It's communication, it's a circuit. I think the circuit is the in the dark matter, in the spirit of the forward and reverse time circuit, where what we see on the material level is, well, no, they're just going the same direction. Well, same, if we look at an artery and vein, it's, oh, that EKG signal is traveling the same on both of them. There's no difference if that's all we're measuring. They're equivalent, but they're not equivalent. There's something else. In the artery and vein, it's the material substance that has a forward and reverse, right? So it's similar and a little bit different. So we have these twisted pairs. We have something called double layers in cosmic plasma. At the heliopause, like where the Voyager spacecraft left our solar system and entered into the galactic field, there's little change, and then all of a sudden, boom, a cell membrane. It's cellular, as above, so below. The nucleus of an atom is cellular. An atom is cellular. A molecule is cellular. An organelle in the cell is cellular. The cell is cellular. An organ is cellular. So we can begin to understand that there's a coherence, there's a cohesiveness to life. We're in a living universe. We are the definition of that this universe is living. There's life in this universe. It's a living universe. The more we look at it from that perspective, we see that life. We see the qualities of life in the quantum weirdness. We see the qualities of life in the amazing cathedral of the heavens that we see in the night sky. Thank you.